All right, good, I guess afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our latest webinar, Catching Up with COVID-19. I'm Amber Canto, the director of the Extension Institute for Health and Wellbeing, and I will be facilitating today's session. This week marks a couple of milestones for us. It has been 2 years since the first case of the novel coronavirus was confirmed in Wisconsin, and it has been 1 year since we held our first webinar on COVID-19 vaccines. And as we continue to navigate the evolving nature of the COVID-19 pandemic and related public health guidance, one thing has remained constant: our Extension colleague and partner desire for access to high quality, evidence-based information to guide you in your roles as trusted messengers in community spaces. Our primary goal today is to address your questions about the current state of the pandemic and address your questions about COVID-19 vaccines, boosters, and strategies for addressing misinformation. Before we get started with today's content, I'd just like to make a few housekeeping items and notes. All of our mics are muted if we're not speaking. Please use the Q&A function for any questions that you would like for us to address during the webinar. And the chat feature will allow you to send questions to specific individuals if you have a specific question. If you're having any tech issues, please chat Chelsea Severin directly. All right, and now to introduce our guests. We have Ajay, Associate Professor in Population Health Sciences and an Infectious Disease Epidemiologist. He is also Faculty Director of the Master of Public Health Program and a 2021 recipient of a Chancellor's Distinguished Teaching Award with UW-Madison School of Medicine and Public Health. And Dr. James Conway is a professor of pediatrics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison School of Medicine and Public Health, where he serves in a variety of leadership positions overseeing pediatric infectious disease and global health educational programs. He is medical director for immunization programs at UW Health and serves on the Wisconsin Council on Immunization Practice. Thank you both so much for being here with us today. We can go ahead and get started with our questions. So we started 2022 with the highly transmissible Omicron variant in wide circulation, record number of COVID-19 infections and hospitalizations. Prior to that, in fall of 2021, we saw the Delta variant widely circulating. Ajay, can you provide us with a sense of where we are at in the pandemic and what are the general trends we're seeing with regards to incidence of infection and hospitalization?
Yeah, thank you, Amber, and thanks for inviting me to be on this panel with Jim. You know, nationally, we are still in the middle of the Omicron spike. And, you know, and although daily cases are declining, they are still at critically high levels. And so the incidence, everybody might know, you know, is grossly underestimated right now, since so many people may forego testing or use an at-home rapid test that doesn't get reported to public health. So I would say that transmission right now is still at the highest levels that we've seen before this Omicron spike. As a result, because of that sheer volume of cases, hospitalizations are unfortunately also at their highest levels ever. It's a lagging indicator, and there are some signs of that turning around, but deaths are continuing to increase. And every day in Wisconsin, unfortunately, 30 people die of COVID on a daily basis.
Thanks, Ajay. And with the potential risk of new variants becoming much more acute in these recent months, what do we know about how these new variants are emerging? What causes them to emerge in the first place?
Yeah, it's complicated, and there are a lot of forces that yield new variants. And for one thing, we just have a lot of ongoing replication of this virus all around the world, here in Wisconsin, in the US, and everywhere. The virus mutates. As mutations develop, sometimes there's a combination of mutations that gives the virus some selective advantage over the other viruses that are present at the time. It's like winning the lottery. So it's rare if you win, but you know, every day somebody does win the lottery when they play. The other way it happens, you know, is sometimes in a single person who is inadequately or is unable to sort of clear the infection if they become sick. They might have a weakened immune system. And in that context, the person might have a persistent infection for months. And a virus that keeps replicating in a person whose immune system is trying to fight it, eventually a variant might emerge that can circumvent that sort of immunity that the person is trying to apply to shutting the virus down, but it doesn't. So in that case, you can also get variants developing. And then the third way is if you have two variants that are co-circulating and a person is infected with both, the genes of these viruses can be exchanged with one another, large chunks of the genetics. And that's called recombination. And that's very rare, but it does happen. So there are a lot of mechanisms. And that's why we've seen several variants over time emerge and then dominate the transmission around the world.
Thank you. And Jim, we've seen that early reports have suggested that the Omicron variant may lead to less severe illness than previous variants of concern. What is the data currently saying about whether this is true and that Omicron may be less severe than previous variants?
Yeah, it's an interesting question, Amber. And you really have to take it with a grain of salt, because with each variant, the playing field has changed. And so, you know, the initial variants were launching into a marketplace of no vaccination, no immunity, and everything was bad. And as we've evolved and seen both increasing immunizations across the United States and globally, as well as at least some short-term immunity after natural infection, we see that there's at least less vulnerable individuals within populations. And so it can appear that these viruses are less virulent, when in fact it's that the population is actually in general probably less susceptible. And so I think you really have to take that with a grain of salt. We have seen, you know, record numbers of kids being hospitalized during Omicron at the same time that people keep hearing the media saying that Omicron's not as severe. And I think it's a great example that with, you know, less than 25% of kids immunized, they are the largest vulnerable population out there. And so they're bearing the brunt of this current circulating virus. So it's milder or it's less severe, but it's milder or less severe because so many people are vaccinated. You know, as Ajay mentioned, you know, we've got record numbers of hospitalizations and record numbers of deaths. And I think people really need to square those two things. They're hearing out of one ear that this is a milder variant. And on the other hand, we've got more disease than we've ever had and sicker people than we've ever had. And it really is still going to be, unfortunately, a pandemic of the unvaccinated as we move forward. And so certainly the immunized individuals and the highly immunized populations may have breakthrough disease that's milder, but it still is devastating in the unvaccinated or in those high-risk individuals who don't respond well to vaccines.
We're going to dig a little bit deeper into sort of the impact of vaccines, but sort of going along those lines of that thread, what are we, you know, you alluded to the fact that we're seeing differences in terms of severe illness and hospitalization with regards to those who have been vaccinated and those maybe who have not. But does that mean that those who have been vaccinated, that the vaccines are not working, in that we're seeing breakthrough infections, we're seeing cases more so, increasing cases across the general population? So maybe honing in a little bit on what does that mean from a breakthrough infection rate? What are we seeing from a population perspective?
Yeah, I think I'll tackle it first and then Ajay may have some comments to add on. But, you know, the way I think about this is that we've really got three populations of people. We've got people that have been vaccinated and boosted. And if you look at our numbers here at UW Health, for instance, we have extraordinarily small numbers of people that ever get into the hospital who are boosted. And so we know that the immunity after the primary series of vaccines wanes and that boosting is clearly important. And that's why CDC has actually kind of relabeled these things. And they had kind of mistakenly used the term fully vaccinated when people had completed their primary series. And they've really shifted the verbiage in the last couple of weeks to doing what we do with most other vaccines, which is what we talk about being up to date with your vaccine series. And so it's now clear that a booster is what you really require to be up to date and fully immune. So when we're seeing breakthrough cases that are in vaccinated individuals, they're almost exclusively people that had their primary series with no booster. But again, you know, the unvaccinated are the ones that are bearing the brunt of this. We do see breakthrough cases in vaccinated individuals who haven't been boosted, but you can literally count on one hand the number of people that are boosted who end up in the hospital. And in fact, most of them are actually being admitted for other reasons and tested sort of incidentally positive. The other thing to just kind of remind people is, you know, you've got to kind of go through life with your glass either half full or half empty. And while I know that people have been continuing to focus on the vaccine hesitant and the vaccine refusers, you know, if you really take a step back and look at the data, you know, just think about these numbers. In people over 65 years of age, 95% have had at least one dose of vaccine, 88% are fully vaccinated. If you're 12 and up, which is the group that's had the longest opportunity to be vaccinated of, you know, when we include children in the calculus, you know, 85% have had one dose and 73% are fully vaccinated. You know, it's the littlest ones that are really the ones that are still way behind and really make up the largest bulk of the unvaccinated population. So if you take the entire U.S. population, including all the little kids, you know, 75% of people have had one dose and 65% are fully vaccinated. But you add on that, you know, estimates are about 20% of Americans have probably been infected. And so I think that as you're asking, you know, sort of what's the future look like, you know, the magic eight ball says ask again later. But in reality, you know, we're reaching some level of herd immunity with vaccines combined with natural infection. And I think that, you know, most people are trying to be a little optimistic and saying that this may start to settle out, but it's still going to be important for people to get vaccinated and protected because, you know, we're already hearing about new variants of concern. The BA2 variant on Omicron now is about 1.5 times more transmissible than Omicron itself. And this is going to keep happening. You know, as Ajay mentioned, there's lots of ways that variants happen. The bottom line is that these viruses are not very smart and they constantly make mistakes as they replicate themselves. And most of those mistakes are bad mistakes, but every once in a while they hit a winner, like Ajay's lottery. And so there's going to be more out there. We've got, you know, literally hundreds of millions of people globally unvaccinated where these viruses are still going to circulate. And there are constantly new variants popping up. So I think we need to be very careful about, you know, what we hear in the media, no offense, and understanding that yes, the national numbers are tapering off. But as Ajay said, we are still right in the midst of the peak because of all that at-home testing that doesn't get reported and included, and knowing that there's always going to be something on the horizon. And so this is a time actually to double down and certainly not take our foot off the gas. This is actually the key time we almost could get ahead of this and maybe end up with almost what happened last summer, which was getting rid of the original strains.
So what does that getting ahead look like? What are those things that we should be doing to help us get ahead of the virus and those future variants?
Well, I think, you know, piece one is sticking with what we've been doing. You know, people testing and isolating if positive and, you know, being cautious if they're exposed. You know, wearing masks while we're in close quarters during periods of time when there's a lot of disease circulating. And most importantly, boosters. And, you know, I do think that there's a long way to go on the boosters. You know, less than half of people have had their booster that are eligible. And a survey came out from the Kaiser Family Foundation a couple of weeks ago that about a third of Americans weren't even aware that they were eligible and that boosters were recommended. So I think that's actually really the key where we are right now is really encouraging people that, you know, that terminology I think was really was a mistake in saying people were fully vaccinated. And it made it seem like the boosters were sort of an add-on for certain people. To be really fully protected and to be up to date, everybody that's eligible needs a booster. And that's actually going to be the most important thing, I think, in not only getting out of this, but staying out of this.
And all those individuals who are eligible now for a booster would be anyone 12 and older, right? And so I know folks have also asked, can we anticipate regular boosters, right? So should we be looking ahead to a fourth booster, some kind of yearly booster or yearly vaccine schedule, much like the flu? What do we know today by way of what we might anticipate there?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to fall in the to be determined still, but I think it's, you know, people should be aware that all of the major manufacturers of the vaccines are currently working on all those things. They're working on Omicron-specific boosters. They're working on combination vaccines where flu vaccine and COVID vaccines can be combined. So all of that is happening in the background. You know, nobody at any point has, you know, brushed their hands and said, okay, we declare victory, we're done. This is a constant process. And, you know, I think people also need to remember that you know, vaccine trials are one thing, and then the constant follow-up that goes along with following now hundreds of millions of people, both looking for side effects, you know, of which there's been no surprises, but also looking for how durable that immunity is and what do we need and when. You know, I think it's going to really be to be determined. I wouldn't be surprised if we may need another booster at some point after this third dose, but I don't know that we're going to be stuck with this indefinitely. It's really going to be one of those things that time will tell.
I'll say that the local epidemiology also, actually global epidemiology also determines the need for boosters. If case rates were low, even if people's antibody levels were down, there isn't a need to have circulating antibodies in your body if there's not a virus in the community to fight or to become infected by. When we have a surge and the risk of breakthrough infection is high, having people boosted gives them that protection that's really important. But it's a give and take. As we control the pandemic moving forward, the need for boosters will decline unless there are new variants for which we, as Jim said, you know, need a variant-specific vaccine or booster or some other tweak in the strategy. So it's, you know, all of these things have to work in concert.
We had a question come through the chat box that is timely for our current topic. What is the time frame after last vaccination that people become eligible for a booster?
Yeah, so it's been changing, which I think is why it's a great question. And so, you know, the current guidelines is that after you've had your primary series with Moderna or Pfizer, that your booster is you're eligible for your booster at 5 months, and then if you got a Johnson & Johnson vaccine, that you're eligible for a booster at 2 months after that original dose. And the current guidelines suggest that for the Johnson & Johnson recipients, at least, that they're best off getting one of the mRNA vaccines as their booster, as opposed to Moderna and Pfizer, which is, you know, basically you can get anything that's available, that they're all reasonable. Mm-hmm. The caveat to that is obviously with this relatively large immune compromised population, where their primary series is actually three doses followed by a booster. So that population actually technically gets four doses. They get their three-dose series initially, and then their booster is due, again, 5 months after they've completed that primary series. And for people that fit into that group, you know, since you're, while relatively large, you know, still a minority, you do have to sometimes stick up for yourself when you're scheduling that additional dose, whether it's with pharmacies or clinicians, because a lot of the electronic medical record stuff is sort of built around the majority. And so you do need to sort of push people and remind them, tell them that they need to do it because I said so. But that is one of the things we are hearing from folks as more folks are hitting that fourth dose booster timing, is that they're getting a little bit of pushback because of how the information systems were built.
Yeah. We had another related question come in just to clarify, how long after having COVID can an individual get a booster?
Yeah, this has changed also. And I think that people kind of need to understand the reasoning and the messaging. So, you know, early in the pandemic, we were asking people that had been infected to hold off for 90 days, largely because that was about the duration of how long we thought the immunity lasted. And we were really trying to ration vaccines and get to the most vulnerable and to those that were completely vulnerable to the infection. You know, right now, the guidelines are basically that once you've recovered from your illness and are out of your isolation period, you can get your COVID vaccines. And we clearly know that the immunity from these breakthrough cases is really short-lived and really not as thorough as people need. And so regardless of what your COVID infection history is, everybody really does need a booster. So it can be as soon as a couple of weeks after your initial infection once you're out of that isolation period.
Yeah, and I'll say, you know, you stand a chance to have enviable immunity if you have a combination of infection, natural infection, and immunity from that and vaccination. Don't think of this as an either or. If you've had COVID in the past, the vaccines will only boost any immunity you may have had. And that's a good position to be in.
Yeah, and this is not that unusual. I mean, I think people keep saying like, well, natural immunity is better than vaccine immunity. This is actually true for many diseases. You know, whooping cough, pertussis, Haemophilus influenza or HIB, you know, even if you've had those infections, you still need vaccination because the vaccines actually give you better immunity. So nobody should be surprised that natural infection gives you incomplete immunity and that vaccines are still needed. But again, that got confused in the beginning when we were sort of asking people after they had recovered to kind of hold off and let other people go to the front of the line, but for very different reasons.
You mentioned mRNA, Jim, in your response, the mRNA vaccines. And the mRNA vaccines may be presented as newly available to the public, but it's not new technology. In fact, it's been technology that's been developed for years. Maybe you can remind us, how does this technology work to provide protection against disease?
Yeah, actually, all three of the vaccines that are currently available in the United States all basically work the same way. I think for some reason, people have lumped the Johnson & Johnson vaccine in with the AstraZeneca vaccine in Europe, which are very different, although they both use an adenovirus as the delivery vector. They all work the same. And basically, what they do is provide a template to the body that is then made by the body into the important spike glycoproteins, which then get presented to the immune system, and the immune system then develops immunity, and then very quickly that template degrades. You know, it's gone very quickly. But, you know, as you kind of alluded to, I mean, these have been around for about 20 years and were really initially being fashioned as anti-cancer vaccines and anti-Alzheimer's vaccines, and trying to get the body to be able to develop antibodies against certain types of proteins that were bad, cancer proteins, Alzheimer proteins. And then they were going to be used when that was kind of perfected and they started to move into trials for outbreak disease. And so they were actually working on these for Ebola and Zika and HIV. And lo and behold, SARS-CoV-2 shows up, and it was almost perfect timing. I mean, you almost couldn't have asked for something that was a better situation, because they had really perfected all of that. And it was a matter of just plopping something new that needed to be in the template into the vaccine. And that's why they were so readily available and so quickly able to move into clinical trials within a couple of months, is that there was already a lot going on behind the scenes. And so I think this is just such a great example that this actually in many ways may be sort of the new wave of what vaccines all are going to potentially look like. Because as everybody knows, you know, no vaccine protects every recipient, but these vaccines, even against these really, really challenging viral respiratory diseases that have always been a challenge to make vaccines against, the fact that they've been successful, you know, and so successful is something of a medical miracle. And I do think that this is going to be a whole new wave of vaccines that we come to appreciate and come to kind of accept as just sort of the norm over the next couple of years.
We've continued to receive questions around the long-term health and safety effects of these vaccines, sort of understanding the context of ongoing safety and monitoring. And you mentioned, Jim, you know, that the template quickly degrades within the body, but maybe sort of lift up for us, what do we know by way of long-term health or safety effects, if any, of the vaccines that we have available?
Sure. So, I mean, to be clear, you know, the Johnson & Johnson is a DNA vaccine, which makes mRNA, which then makes proteins. The mRNA just makes proteins, and then they fall apart. You know, there's never been a vaccine where any side effect showed up at more than 2 months after the vaccine was given to the recipients. And when we talk about short-term and long-term side effects, short-term are those things that happen in the hours or days after you get the vaccine, swelling of your arm, fever, you know, headache, all the achy stuff. And then within 2 months is when we kind of watch very closely to see if there's anything long-term that happens as that immune system gets activated. But beyond that, there's never in the history of vaccines that I'm aware of anything that's been picked up beyond that. And so really the long-term follow-up for vaccine trials is primarily looking at how long does the immunity actually last, and when might it need a little bit of a nudge and a booster to get back up to protective levels. That's really what those long-term trials are about. And when we talk about the typical vaccines used to take, you know, 5 to 8 years to deliver, it was really that long-term follow-up, trying to decide how long does it last and when do people need more. Obviously, in the face of a pandemic that's killing thousands and thousands of people on a daily basis, that was the one concession, is that we'll, you know, sort of take that part off the table and figure out when our booster is needed. And that's what we've been doing all along for these 2 years, and why we've seen now these changes and recommendations. But that's really how the whole vaccine development process works.
And we just saw news yesterday of the full approval of the Moderna vaccine for individuals 18 and over. Pfizer has already received full approval for those 16 and older. Can you remind us of that distinction between FDA approval and emergency use authorization, which is sort of where we started by way of status of vaccines?
Sure. So emergency use authorization is used during a public health emergency. So there has to be a government declaration that there's a public health emergency. And, you know, various drugs and now vaccines have then been given a preferential approval under emergency use authorization because we're under a public health threat. And so, you know, many drugs get into that space when there's new diseases that emerge. And in this circumstance, they needed to then do the same thing for vaccines. And again, it doesn't remove any of the regulatory oversight, nor does it take away any of the responsibilities of the developers to still cross all the T's and dot all the I's. It really, in many ways, actually gets rid of some of the bureaucratic hurdles. You know, when a company used to submit a drug, the FDA had a full year to respond and tell them what they thought about that, which I think for many years people have been complaining is just overly bureaucratic and needed to be streamlined and improved. And so that was why the emergency use authorization process was even developed. I think most people feel like this is hopefully a new normal where they've basically gotten rid of a lot of these policy administrative log jams and figured out a way to make this a little bit more efficient. The other thing that emergency use authorization allows is, as opposed to the big, what's called a biological license, where the company sort of submits everything all at once, the emergency use authorization process actually allows the companies and scientists to submit data in a rolling fashion as they make more and more discoveries so that it can be reviewed in a constant real-time process so that eventually when they sort of get all the information needed to get to the finish line, then they can very quickly make the decisions that are needed. So in many ways, it was really more of a logistics and administrative change than it was really changing what the science is required to show to get that authorization. Then over time, you know, so Moderna had submitted back in summer of 2021 for their full licensure. You know, they had finally accumulated enough long-term data to be able to submit that. And even then, the FDA basically wanted more time and wanted more data on certain topics before they were comfortable. And so I think that they've shown us that even in under the pressure of a pandemic, they're not going to cut corners, that they are going to stick by the rules. And, you know, while everybody wanted this to be done sooner, better late than never, and better that the science is carefully done and that the administrative side of this really, you know, held up to what it's supposed to do.
Yeah, I just want to say that you still hear rhetoric out there that people call the vaccines experimental, and you know the clinical trials were done in 2020. We're way past that, and that lingering rhetoric almost makes the person who uses that language look silly. It's just wrong. Obviously, the vaccines were authorized initially, and now both Pfizer and Moderna approved. Once when you reach that kind of status by the FDA, which is a, as Jim outlined, is a process that really the whole world envies. We have very strict criteria to get that label of something being approved. The public should feel safe, you know, feel that the vaccines are now safe and effective. We already knew that, and now it's really official. It's kind of time to move on from all that misinformation that circulates that unfortunately is used to scare people. And we have to be better, you know, we have to be better as a society about that.
Thank you both. And maybe turning our attention a little bit more specifically to vaccines and vaccination in children. And Jim, I think you alluded to this earlier, but despite being eligible for months, we've only seen about 25% of 5 to 11-year-olds in Wisconsin that have received at least one vaccine dose. It's a little bit lower than the national rate. We've also seen disparities with regards to vaccine access, particularly amongst communities of color within the state, and also globally as well. But maybe just starting on the messaging points for vaccines between those 5 to 11-year-olds. As a pediatrician, Jim, what are some of the key messages that you convey to parents regarding safety and effectiveness of COVID vaccines in children?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting topic and an interesting challenge. You know, I think there's two sides to this. So first off, on the disease itself, I think a lot of people are still functioning under this sort of misinformation that this is a milder variant and the kids do fine with this infection. You know, I think that we kind of fooled ourselves by being a victim of our own success early in the pandemic. If you close schools, restrict travel, have everybody wear masks and only get takeout food, yeah, it's pretty easy to protect kids and have them not get infected. Put them back in school and let people, you know, get back to their business and traveling, and you start to see what the reality is, which is the kids are just as vulnerable to this disease as everybody else. And that unfortunately they have two opportunities to get whacked by it. You know, they have the acute illness with the respiratory symptoms that land the majority of the adults in the hospital. But kids have this other problem that we've actually seen more and more of. And, you know, we have now more kids in the hospital than we've had at any point during the pandemic, which is this thing called MISC disease, or multisystem inflammatory syndrome of children. What that is that kids' immune systems are so good that they overdo it sometimes as they fight off the virus and just forgets to turn off. And their immune system essentially starts attacking themselves. And so, you know, kids really do unfortunately suffer in multiple ways from this. And then in addition, obviously, you know, what happens in society trickles down on the kids and makes them have to deal with abnormal settings or even closure of their school. As far as the vaccines themselves, you know, I think people are understandably cautious when it comes to their kids. You know, it's one thing to do something for yourself, but I think people are very protective of their children. And so I do understand that, you know, initially when these vaccines came out under an emergency use authorization with, you know, large but not enormous studies, that there were a substantial number of people that sort of wanted to wait and see. And I think part of that was colored by sort of equating the side effects that were being seen with the full adult dose in the teenagers, worrying that we could see, you know, any kind of side effects like that in littler kids. The key thing about the little kids, 5 to 11-year-olds, is that the dose they get is only a third of what we give to the adolescents and adults, with basically development of the exact same type of immunity without needing nearly as much of a dose. And they get by with a lot less side effects in most circumstances. And I think as we're learning, you know, they are really, again, bearing the brunt. They're the majority of the unvaccinated population now. And so they're getting sick a lot more than everybody else. And certainly while a lot of them do okay with it, it's still disruptive to their homes and their schools, and some of them do end up here in the hospitals. And so, you know, we feel very strongly that kids deserve equal opportunity to be protected against this virus, that these viruses are really unpredictable. And you just never can predict, no matter how healthy a kid is, how they're going to do with it. And that we've got now, you know, tens of millions of kids that have received these vaccines with really good safety data that show that they have even less side effects than the older individuals. And so now is actually the best time to do this, because we'd love to get through the rest of this semester and actually be able to have a normal summer for these kids. And this is really going to be the key part to not only getting this peak to settle down soon, but to keep another one from emerging as we go forward.
I alluded also in some of those introductory remarks that we might also have some of these disparities by way of vaccination, not only from age groups, but also across race and ethnicity, due to some structural factors, social and economic inequalities and inequities, for example, that have led to disproportionate impact on communities of color, not only by way of infection by COVID-19, but also vaccine access, and also vaccine access for children. So Ajay, I'm curious, from your perspective, what can public health and community organizations do to help overcome some of these barriers and really support increase of equitable access to vaccines for all?
I mean, public health has been doing this. This has been a mission of public health from the beginning, and progress really has been made just through engaging local communities. You know, here in Dane County, there were some initial lower rates of vaccination in the Latinx community, but those gaps have really narrowed because of really strong outreach and community engagement by the public health people here at the university. And there's progress made, you know, in all groups. It's not perfect, but, you know, I think the progress that's been made over the last year should be lauded.
Yeah, just to tack on to that, you know, I think you can never let a good pandemic go by without learning some important lessons. And I think we've really learned and heard loud and clear. And I think, you know, in this period of time where we're also focused on diversity, equity, and inclusion, you know, this has been a great reminder that there need to be leaders and professionals from communities that are then spokespeople both for those communities and to those communities. And I think we've heard these communities loud and clear and have figured out ways to engage not only with people from within those communities, but also people that that are respected within those communities. I think this is important and a long-term time coming and is really going to be a positive as we go forward, that I think there's going to be a lot more people and a lot more groups represented at the table as we go forward on all sorts of different public health measures that really do need to involve a community-based approach rather than a top-down, this is what the government says we need to do. I think this is actually going to be a turning point for public health as we go forward as a society.
Yeah, it's a great reminder that those who are most impacted by these issues are also closest to the solutions. And so creating opportunities for communities to lead is really, really critical. Before we move on, sort of looking ahead into the future, lots of folks have questions, Jim, about where we are at with clinical trials for vaccines for children 4 and younger. I know you are directly involved in some of these trials. What are you able to share with us with regards to anticipated timelines, what we might be expecting to hear soon with those vaccines for children 4 and under?
Yeah, we're making great progress. And, you know, I can't express enough appreciation to the public and those who have been eager and willing to sign up their kids and be involved in this scientific process. It's been really actually very refreshing and heartening, the wait lists we have of people that are really eager to help get these questions answered on behalf of the greater good has been really, really refreshing. Both Moderna and Pfizer are well into their clinical trials and are sort of getting close. You know, we can kind of see the finish line in the distance. You know, Pfizer's two-dose series at a very, very low dose of their vaccine for the 6-month to 4-year-olds was shown to be very, very safe, but didn't get quite to the threshold of immunity that they were looking for. And so they've decided to move towards having a third dose for that population. I think people are going to be hearing in the news over the next couple of days that they're nonetheless being encouraged to submit that preliminary data to the FDA so that they can start reviewing it, as we just talked about, with that kind of rolling process. So they can review that data and see, is there enough there to justify then at least allowing kids in those age groups to start getting vaccinated with that vaccine, knowing that then there would be likely a booster or a third dose eventually to be needed, but a lot of discussion going on about whether it's reasonable to keep waiting until the studies are completed, now that we've at least got the safety side of it, and then figure out kind of how many doses over time. So you'll see a lot of talk about that in the next couple of days and weeks. And if that does go forward, you know, you could theoretically see vaccine available from Pfizer for those kids probably by early March. Moderna is taking a little bit of a different approach, and their two dose of much lower dose than the adults receive is looking very promising, and they're sort of moving towards being in the final stages of completion and are likely going to be submitting their data in the coming months. So I'm increasingly optimistic that 6-month to 4-year-old age group will likely be able to start getting vaccinated in the second quarter of 2022. So I'm hoping by sometime in March or April, we'll start to see that happening. And I know there's, you know, lots of families that are going to be early adopters and eager to start to get that sense of safety for those kids so that they can really start to move into even more of a normalcy for them.
Great. I want to just invite folks, y'all have been sticking questions into the Q&A, and we're addressing them as we go. Please keep them coming, and we will be sure to circle back on those as we keep moving along. Ajay, I want to turn it to you now to talk a little bit about misinformation. And we have seen that misinformation regarding COVID and the vaccines have been pervasive. Maybe first to start, what are some of the key strategies that individuals should consider for addressing misinformation?
Yeah, very complex topic. And, you know, we all probably have friends and family members, you know, whose views are just different from our own. And I'm not implying that they're wrong or we're right or the opposite. Point is, you have different viewpoints. I always remind myself that my job is not to change people's minds. They have to change their own mind, because that's what I see my role as, is to be supportive of somebody who is in that position to potentially change their mind. I think in the context of vaccines, you know, there's hesitancy and then there's outright resistance. And you have to, in a sense, you know, size up sort of what is the impact that misinformation has had for this person? Are they at all open to having a conversation about getting vaccinated or talking about the impacts of COVID in our society? And I think if there's some resistance there, I'd rather just really do nothing but listen, just so I can educate myself and understand what really is sort of the underlying emotion somebody's feeling. I might tackle those emotions, but I won't try to fact check or I won't try to correct somebody. They have to do that themselves. I also think listening, as I said, is just very important, active listening. Have a lot of empathy for people. People, you know, live in their bubbles. We do, I do. We're bombarded with information constantly that makes us feel good, confirms things that we know. Most people don't get out of their comfort zone of information that they seek to hear or see what the other side, if you will, is talking about. And so when we're in our bubbles, it may surprise us that other people have different views, but it really shouldn't.
And I know that you talked a little bit about empathy and listening and sort of meeting people where they're at, if you will, in part of that strategy. You also highlighted the importance of individuals needing to make a decision for themselves. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the things we've been trying to do with an extension is ensure that folks have access to the answers to the questions that they may have to make a decision that is right for them. What other strategies or sort of supports might you offer to our extension colleagues and our partners out there in the state by way of helping connect individuals who are seeking information to help make that decision? Where would they go? What are those, you know, trusted resources that you might refer to or connection points that you would lift up for our colleagues?
Yeah, I mean, it may sound standard, but I think it's an important point, is that people should always think about going to their doctor or a healthcare provider for information about the vaccines when they have questions. If somebody is at a point where, you know, they, again, have more resistance towards something like vaccination, I think, you know, resistance is hard to crack, but some people might actually be a little bit more open-minded than we realize. They just might not outwardly want to express that they're open-minded, but we hear anecdotes all the time of healthcare providers who talk to their patients about vaccination. They say no, but then a couple of weeks later, they go ahead and get vaccinated. They might not want to openly admit that to people in their family, social circles, because they are in this bubble where getting vaccinated is not popular among their friends. But people are doing it. And the numbers, you know, we're chipping away at that. As Jim said, the vast majority of people have had at least one dose. It's not the norm anymore to have this sort of 50-50 society. I kind of think locally, you know, every community, no matter how low the overall vaccination rate is, every community has lots of people who have chosen vaccination, and getting those people to talk to each other, the ones who are on the fence or resistant even, talking to people who they see as their peers, as their local leaders, as people they trust, is a good source of information and opportunity to talk about it.
Yeah, let me just jump on, because I mean, I think Ajay just hit on something really important, which is, you know, the normalization of what we all, you know, start to think is the norm. And so I think that one of the things that we need people to do is that as people are vaccinated and as they start to become more comfortable that they really prefer to hang around with other vaccinated people, is to be more open about that and to be more comfortable in recognizing that being vaccinated, being fully vaccinated, is the norm. And I think if people both share that and share that with their networks and are hopefully at some level proud of it. And even starting to actually take the flip side of the coin, which is expressing what we hear all the time, which is that they're uncomfortable being around their friends that are unvaccinated. I think actually admitting that to people and saying, like, look, I know you've believed this for a long time, but, you know, me and my family have finally all decided to be vaccinated and we're uncomfortable being around you, maybe actually does start to change the conversation a little bit. And you know, people, I think we're hearing again anecdotally, but more and more people that had sort of like dug a line in the sand for whatever reasons, political or others, have just started to recognize that, you know, those days are kind of done. And now they're just sort of becoming outliers that, you know, may actually start to be excluded from things or may not be able to participate in certain things. And that while they may not really believe this up front, there is a sense of relief. I think I know many of us felt it when we first got vaccinated, and we still hear those stories about people that either were reluctant or they're, you know, we had a teenager the other day whose parents were reluctant to let her get vaccinated, and they finally conceded. And the joy that she expressed to her friends and, you know, in finally being one of them and finally having been given permission. And she said to me when I saw her in clinic the other day, you know, she said, I just feel all of a sudden like this weight is off of me and I can be normal, that I don't have to be the one who's always being ultra paranoid. And, you know, she said, I know nothing's that different, but everything's different. And I think people deserve to feel that feeling and be able to be a little bit more comfortable navigating that, even if they have the misfortune of getting exposed, that the likelihood would be that with a breakthrough infection that they do end up with a mild case that doesn't get them into the hospital or something worse. So I think that there's a movement, and I think Ajay hit it right on the head, that we need to talk more about it, but we need to talk more about it locally with our circles of friends and neighbors.
You know, I just want to also just chime in about something Jim just said, and that is, you know, the idea that people who are vaccinated and boosted can start feeling comfortable again. And a lot of people have, but there are still people, I think, who are now, we might say, are the worried well in a way. And in the New York Times, David Leonhard had talked about this using some national opinion poll data, that individuals were asked how worried they are about getting COVID in the next year. And the unvaccinated people are not worried, but they should be, and calls that some sort of irrational skepticism. And then there are people who are vaccinated and boosted, and they're also just as worried about getting COVID in the future, also having a skepticism that you would say is irrational. That this is one of those examples of, yeah, both sides do it. When you are at one end or the other, the answer is in the middle ground, that we will be able to navigate this as people grow their confidence in the vaccines, if they got vaccinated or if they're not vaccinated. We need to just continue to hammer that the vaccines are safe and effective, and we can all be confident that they are our tool to get out of this.
So Ajay, you touched on continuing to navigate, continuing to manage, and sort of looking ahead. And we are arguably probably from day one of this pandemic have heard the language of endemic, right? In an endemic state, and when will we reach it? I think perhaps increasingly we're continuing to see more of those conversations and folks who are ready to get back to some kind of normalcy, whatever that might mean for them. But let's first start with the definition of what does it mean for an infectious disease to be endemic?
Yeah, so, you know, we can get into numbers, and I think there's a lot of debate as to sort of what those numbers ought to be. I think a couple of things are clear, is that we need some stability in sort of how COVID transmits in the community so that it's predictable. It also needs to be at a level that's, you know, manageable. And then once when we get into that, I think determining what's endemic really becomes more of a qualitative assessment than a quantitative one. It really needs to reflect what society is willing to tolerate. And let's face it, from the very beginning of the pandemic, and certainly since vaccinations became available and today, there are a lot of people who are behaving as if COVID is pandemic or maybe not even existent. I think we need to have all of society to sort of at some point stop talking about COVID, right? That's a sign that it's become endemic. We're a little ways from that. I think as long as we're dealing with absenteeism at the workplace and schools, that's very disruptive to workplaces in our economy. As long as healthcare systems are really burned out, that the public health sector is also very burned out, that's a sign that we're not at some state of endemicity. I think there's sort of the state where people aren't feeling threatened by COVID anymore. 2020, COVID was the number three leading cause of death in the US. Completely unheard of that a brand new infectious disease can do that, but it did. It's still remaining a top cause of death in the US. And if we can reduce that to the point where we have death rates in the country that are reflective of what they were before COVID, and we don't have all these excess deaths, not just due to COVID, but opioid-related overdoses and other sequelae of this pandemic, I think we'll feel like we are ready to move on, even though some people already have, unfortunately.
Yeah, just to add on, you know, when we think about pandemics, we sort of think about five stages. You know, we start out with the true pandemic, then we go into deceleration, and then ultimately control or endemicity when it becomes endemic. And, you know, I think that's where people sort of hope we'll end up. You know, you can then think about the next two stages, which are elimination and then eradication, but those will be difficult. And we've got lots of endemic diseases that we deal with. I mean, influenza is probably the classic, you know, that as a society, we've been willing to put up with 20 to 30, you know, million cases, some years even more, you know, 20 to 30,000 deaths, some year as many as 50,000 deaths a year. And yet only 40, 45% of people get their vaccine every year. You know, so I think that we clearly know that, at least in our society, that there are some diseases that people are willing to just put up with and take risks with. And so I think that that's what, you know, I think people envision endemic might look like. I think the biggest unanswered question still is whether this virus will respect seasonality or not. I think for most endemic respiratory viruses, they become tolerable because they have a seasonality when you have to deal with them, but also that you can sort of gear up and manage boosting of vaccines in a timely fashion. If these do what they seem to have done over the last couple of years and continue to circulate primarily when the windows are closed and people are indoors, that's a different game. You know, that's what we saw last summer. Things were fine up here in the north, but Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, and Texas had an incredible surge due to heat and people indoors with air conditioning. And then it flips on its head and, you know, becomes less common down there when we've all got the windows closed and the heat on. And so that's very different than most other circulating respiratory viruses. That'll be tricky because I don't know that there's going to be as much of a societal tolerance of a constant endemic respiratory virus like this as opposed to a seasonal one. And so what that leads to, you know, is anybody's guess, but I think that it actually may lead to continued a little bit more aggressive enforcement of a lot of the measures that people have been taking. You know, you're seeing plenty of concert venues and others that only allow people in with vaccines or a negative test and, you know, things like that. So if this becomes a year-round endemic situation, then you might see different measures than what we do for influenza, but with secondary benefits. Because as we've all seen, these last couple of years of influenza have actually been, you know, relatively mild compared to where we are usually with historical disease, but also some disruption in just when things show up. You know, we had an RSV outbreak in the middle of August, which is usually a January, February, very predictable virus. And so I think things are going to be disrupted for a while. But endemic, as Ajay says, means it's something that we've kind of figured out a way to live with and at some level are willing to live with.
Well, before we get to some closing thoughts, I just want to address maybe some of the remaining questions we have in our Q&A here. One relates to infection timelines. The question is, how long after an exposure, and I would presume of current sort of predominant strain of Omicron, could we expect to see symptoms? And when is the best time to test after an exposure?
Yeah, it's really variable. You know, so I think that the general recommendations currently are that if you're exposed and have zero symptoms, the testing on day 5 to 7 actually gets you the most assured answer. You know, the problem, especially with the rapid tests, is that, you know, it's easy to test too early. Before, and, you know, certainly their value is when you have symptoms. they're not as valuable when you don't have symptoms, because essentially they require a certain amount of virus to be able to become positive. And so when you're symptomatic, they're very, very helpful in telling you, is my snotty nose and scratchy throat just a cold or is it COVID? Mm-hmm. If you have absolutely no symptoms and you want to see if you've had a really high quality exposure, if you're infected and you still have no symptoms, probably day 5 to 7. And so there's plenty of people that sort of are kind of wishful thinking because they hear that the incubation period can be as short as 3 days. But a negative test on day 3 doesn't mean you're not infected. It just means you don't have enough stuff there to detect it. You know, and again, the other thing that we haven't talked about is the difference between the PCR tests and the antigen tests. Antigen tests are great if you have symptoms, not so great if you don't have symptoms, unless it's been, you know, again, a decent amount of time. PCR is much more sensitive and picks things up when symptoms are milder and there's less virus there, but then they stay positive for a while, even after you're over your symptoms. So they both have utility. They both are very important, but we need to use them and understand the uses of them for different circumstances.
I'm going to have a slightly different take on that answer and say just, the practical side of things, if you've had an exposure, I think people have to ask themselves, can you stay at home? And if you can't, and if you have to be at work the next day and you feel just fine and you're vaccinated, well, maybe it's not a bad idea to get that well-fitted mask on and wear it more, be more disciplined about wearing it. The incubation period on average is shorter for Omicron. As Jim said, it can still range quite a bit. And if you have access to multiple rapid tests, start testing maybe as early as 2 days, because people sometimes might be positive. And you can make decisions one day at a time. If you don't hang your hat all on one sort of test on a certain day to decide what you're going to do, just to be practical about it. If you are unable to isolate, if you have a gathering coming up that you can't avoid, and really if you can't avoid it, do the right things in order to minimize the chance that you will spread the virus to others. And a mask has to be part of the conversation when it comes to shortened, quarantine or isolation. If you're exposed, you ought to think about wearing a mask. And in fact, even if you're not exposed, we have a lot of indoor mask mandates around the state and in the country, and those are still very important. So got to put it all together, I think.
Well said. Nice summary.
Well, I want to acknowledge we have a couple of questions in the Q&A that we probably are not going to get to, but very happy to follow up with some additional resources after today's webinar. And I just want to close with an acknowledgement that it's been a long and hard 2 years for everyone. Looking to both of you, Ajay and Jim, what are some things that bring you hope with regards to the future of COVID-19?
Let me say something so Jim can have the final word here, and I'm going to steal what Jim said earlier, and that is, a lot of people have chosen vaccination. And he pointed out something I think it's very important. And that is, there's a lot of anger among people who are vaccinated towards the people who are unvaccinated. And there's still a substantial number of people who fall in that category, but it's not the norm. And I think it's important that we remain positive about how we continue to make progress towards vaccination. And that ultimately is going to be really important. To protect individuals and our communities. And I think we should be proud about how quickly we actually have vaccinated this amount. If you really think about it, did you really expect everybody to get vaccinated within a month in the entire country? I don't think anybody would have expected that or asked the public to even do that. And initially there were supply issues. But from April 19th, when everybody became eligible, to today, we've doubled the vaccination rates virtually, pretty much. And I think that's really good. And it will continue to increase.
Yeah, I'll just add on and say that, this has been a remarkable time that we've been through. And, we've all seen how powerful science is and how quickly and efficiently it can move, especially when people agree to collaborate. I think people need to understand, though, that in this era of widespread media, both social and mainstream media, that when you're doing science in a fishbowl, that you have to understand the scientific method is that people make discoveries and put them out there, and then people have to replicate them to prove if they're really true or not. and that we're in the middle of a story that we're writing as we go. And that as we learn more, then people try to figure out how to share that and use that information and understand that this isn't over yet. And this is going to continue. There's going to continue to be new discoveries. People are going to figure out new ways to look at things and new technologies that they're going to bring to bear. And I think we need to all be open-minded and patient in understanding that this is still a process. But I think it's hopefully been something that has helped a lot of people become much more savvy and much more aware of these things. I think everybody at some level has almost become like a junior epidemiologist, a junior virologist, and at least have some familiarity with a lot of the terms that, you know, three, four years ago, most people hadn't even heard these things. And I think that that's going to be important because this isn't going to be, you know, this is the third probably big pandemic of my life, you know, the HIV pandemic and then the H1N1 pandemic in 2009. And now this one, this happens every decade or two. People forget quickly, but hopefully this will help people understand the importance of public health and the importance of letting science kind of have its space to do what it needs to do. And I think we just all need to do a better job of understanding that and then sharing that information in a way that other people can understand and act upon. And then finally, just being more inclusive about the people that are involved in all these conversations as we get these things started and then move them along, that we really need to make this a group effort. I think we're all better together as a society and as a community. And I think we've realized that more than ever during this pandemic, that we got to get out of our bubbles and help each other. And if we continue to do that and help people understand these things, I think there is a path out of this for a better future.
Awesome.
Well, thank you both so much for your time today. We always enjoy your perspectives and your company in these conversations. And want to thank you all who were with us today and who joined us. We will post the recording of this webinar on our website, hopefully within a week. As soon as we get it cleaned up and ready to post publicly, we will send out a note by email once it's available for viewing and sharing. Have a great day, everybody, and we look forward to our next conversation.
Yeah.
Thank you.